At Christmas time, I absolutely love the joy of seeing Christmas lights everywhere. But lights are not just for decoration. The lights of Christmas are symbolic. If you want to know what you're doing in a room that's dark, the first thing you have to do is switch on the light. And Christmas contains many spiritual truths, but we won't understand what Christmas is about if we don't first grasp the fact that the world is a very dark place. You're right. We'll never find our way in the darkness unless Jesus is our light. And Isaiah, who we saw earlier on the screen, in Isaiah chapter 9, he tells us that the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. But how is the world dark? In the Bible, darkness is described in two ways. It's described as a picture of evil, but also as a picture of ignorance. And the world is filled with so much evil and suffering. When we just think of what was going on at the time when the Lord Jesus Christ was born, we think of the oppression that there was. We think of the injustice. We think of the violence. We think of the abuse of power by Herod and others. We think of refugees fleeing from oppression. And we think of families deeply grieving. Doesn't sound that much different from our world today. But darkness in the Bible also refers to the fact that we are in the dark. No one knows enough to be able to rescue the world and cure the world of all the evil and suffering. And at the end of the previous chapter, Isaiah tells us why we need light from God. The people of those days were consulting mediums and magicians. They were looking for light anywhere other than from God. And so we read at the end of chapter 8, distressed and hungry, they will roam through the land, they will look toward the earth and see only distress and darkness and fearful gloom. The people are looking towards the earth. They're looking for human solutions. They're looking for human ways to fix the world. They're looking at experts and gurus. They're looking at mystics and scholars for solutions. And they're saying, yes, we can see our world is in darkness, but we have the light within us. We can fix the world ourselves. We can overcome the darkness. And people do the same today. Some look to leaders and to government. I think we all look to technology. Some look to the stock market. Some look to relationships. Some look to just wealth and education or medicine, or the list is endless. And people say, we have this light within us. If we could just work together, we could bring unity and love and peace to the world. But can we? Can we? Tim Keller, in his book about Christmas, on which I've based my message this evening, quotes Vaclav Havel. He was the first Czech president of the Czech Republic, and Havel knew that science, unguided by moral principle, gave us the Holocaust. And President Havel says, pursuit of the good life will not help humanity save itself, nor is democracy alone enough. A turning to and seeking of God is needed. So Havel argues that the belief that we can save ourselves actually leads us further into darkness. And perhaps you tonight are like the atheist philosopher Bertrand Russell. Maybe you hear and you say, I don't really get what Christmas is about. It's a nice tradition, but I don't believe in God. I don't believe that there's any supernatural dimension to reality. And perhaps you look only to yourself or only to science for light. Well, Bertrand Russell writes, no heroism, no intensity of thought and feeling can preserve an individual life beyond the grave. All the labors of the ages, all the devotion, all the inspiration, all the noonday brightness of human genius are destined to extinction in the vast death of the solar system. And that the whole temple of man's achievement must inevitably be buried beneath the debris of a universe in ruins. Russell confirms what Isaiah is saying, that when you look to the earth, things only get darker. And so I believe that Christmas is the most unsentimental and most realistic way to look at life. On the one hand, Christianity doesn't just say, cheer up, let's pull together and we can make the world invincible in a better place, so to speak. Christianity does seek to do that, but nowhere does the Bible give us the illusion that we can change the world ultimately. But nor does Christianity go to the other extreme that Russell goes to and mopes around in doom and gloom and despair. Instead, the message of Christianity says, yes, things are really this dark. Yes, we're not going to bury our heads in the sand. Let's face the evil and suffering in the world. Yes, let's be honest with ourselves. We cannot save ourselves. But Christianity says, but nevertheless, there is hope. There is hope. And Christmas light bursts into the darkness. And Isaiah says, on those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. Light has dawned from outside of the world. It hasn't come from within. It's dawned on us from outside. And as John tells us, Jesus is the light of the world. And so Isaiah is using the dawning sun as a symbol. What does the sun do? The sun gives us life. If the sun goes out and doesn't rise tomorrow morning, we all freeze to death. We've all lost the relationship that we once had with God at the beginning. And as a result, we will all eventually know physical death. But right now in this moment, we all know spiritual death. A loss of meaning and hope apart from Christ. A deep thirst that never seems to be satisfied. And maybe you're trying all sorts of things. Where's the perfect relationship? Where's the perfect job? Where's the perfect this or that? It doesn't exist. We live in a fallen world. And so we keep trying to satisfy our thirst. And our shame and our struggles with our identity, our inability to change ourselves, those are all symptoms of a deeper disease that we're alienated from God. And just like the sun gives life, whether you believe in the sun or not, whether you walk around with your head down and say, I don't believe the sun exists, right now that sun is sustaining you. And the sun of heaven is sustaining your life, the breath in your lungs, the beating of your heart, whether you acknowledge him or not. But the sun also shows us truth. If you drive home tonight without your car lights on, you'll probably crash. Light reveals the true nature of things as they really are. And God is the source of truth. And unless we respond to God's truth, unless he opens our eyes so that we can see the light of his glory, we'll continue to bump around and stumble in darkness. But the sun is also beautiful. Think of the beauty of light. It dazzles us. And think of the places in the world where certain people have got it really bad. Maybe they live near the North Pole and at certain seasons they just don't have hours of daylight. Or where Noel comes from, I don't think he ever sees the sun. So I don't know, you must get sun somewhere, Noel, because you're certainly not depressed. But if you don't see the sun, so many people become depressed just from that natural reality. Augustine once said, our hearts are restless until they find their rest in thee. And Tim Keller beautifully writes, even when you seem to be enjoying something else, God is the actual source of your joy. The thing you love is from him and is lovely because it bears his signature. All joy is really found in God, and anything you do that you do enjoy is derivative because what you really are looking for is him, whether you know it or not. So how can this light dawn on us tonight? Well, Isaiah tells us, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and he'll be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. These are titles that belong supremely to God alone. And yet he has been born among us as the Lord Jesus Christ. If Jesus Christ really is Mighty God and Everlasting Father, then you can't just like him tonight. You can't just have a sentimental sort of love of Jesus. Because when people in Jesus' day realized what he was claiming for himself, they either got angry with him, they were either furious, they either just walked away, were scared of him, or they fell to their knees and bowed down in worship. Nobody simply liked him. Nobody said, oh, he's so inspiring, he's such a good teacher. Oh, I want to build my life on this and I want him to give me a better life. No, if the baby Jesus that was born at Christmas is truly God, then you must serve him completely. And if Jesus Christ is Wonderful Counselor and Prince of Peace, you should want to serve him. I don't know about you, but I seek counsel from people that will understand me and that know what I'm going through. And we have a God that was born in a manger, unlike any other religion, who knows what it is to suffer, who knows what it is to experience the whole of human life, who knows what it is to be tortured and even to die. The mighty God became one of us. No wonder Isaiah describes him as Wonderful Counselor. He saved us by going to the cross, and he did it all freely out of sheer love. And I don't know about you, but when I find something beautiful, I think about it, I dwell on it, I just pause. I've got to take it in for what it is in and of itself. And so we obey him, not because we have to, but because we want to. He's wonderful. And so Jesus is the light of the world. Like the sun, he brings new life to replace our spiritual deadness. He shows us truth and heals our spiritual blindness. And he is the beauty that breaks our addictions to money, to sex, and to power. Things that we're looking for that we think are beautiful, but they always overpromise and underdeliver. So as we close, how can this light become yours? Well, Isaiah says, to us a son is given. He's given, which means he is a gift, which means the only way to receive this Christmas gift is to recognize that it is an undeserved gift. When Jesus went to the cross, he paid the penalty for my sin and your sin. And we've got to trust what he's done fully. If we're still relying on our own moral behavior to save us, we're not accepting what he's done as a gift. And when we do that, and we accept his gift as our gift, God forgives us and accepts us and changes us from the inside out. But the only way to receive it is to admit that it's an undeserved gift. And that's what Christmas is about. It's about receiving gifts. Think about how challenging it is to receive some gifts. You really have to swallow your pride with some gifts. Maybe you've got some family members who've given you some strange things, but imagine opening a present on Christmas Day from your spouse, and it's a book, and it says, dieting. You have to swallow your pride. So you go to the second gift, and you open it, and it's also a book, and it says, overcoming selfishness. Now, if you say to your spouse, ah, thank you so much, in the process of saying thank you, you're admitting that you're pretty fat, pretty lazy, pretty rude, pretty obnoxious, and the list goes on. So by accepting a gift like that, you're having to say, I have weaknesses. You're right, I need help. And that's hugely humbling. And I think that there's never been a gift that's been offered on planet Earth like the gift of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ that will cause you and I to swallow our pride more. Before I was a Christian, I was caught up in what I had achieved. Maybe I was even arrogant because I didn't think I needed God because I had it all together. Christmas means admitting that you are so lost that God had to come an infinite distance for you. It's admitting that you were so broken that you couldn't save yourself. It means admitting that only the death of the Son of God can save you. And that means that you are not somebody who has your life together and can live a moral and good life that pleases God. None of us can please God. That's why Jesus had to come. And perhaps that's why you haven't trusted him tonight, because you're still working on this performance treadmill, maybe even seeking out religion to do a lot of stuff to be right with God. Just admit that you're a sinner who needs to be saved by grace, and you'll see his beauty. Just recognize that you can't find your way in the darkness. You've been trying too long, turning over a new leaf every year, and it lasts 2 weeks. Admit that you need God to change you from the inside out. Friends, that means descending far lower than I think any of us thought we'd ever go. But I want you to know tonight that Jesus Christ's love went lower than that when he entered the world of darkness and died on a cross in our place. All glory be to Jesus Christ, the light of the world. I close with the words of the Apostle John. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world. And though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. And my prayer is that each one of us would recognize Christ this Christmas, the light of the world. Let's pray together. In the quietness of these moments, maybe search your heart. If we can help you in any way as a church, if I can help you, if you want to contact us at the office in the week, do so. But let's just come before the Lord in prayer. Oh Lord Jesus, we want to thank you again for this gift that we don't deserve. Lord, you couldn't stand the infinite distance between us, and for reasons known only to you, you chose to come this distance to offer us a gift, to save us when we had rebelled against you, when we had shaken our fists in your face. Thank you for grace. Thank you for mercy. Thank you for Christmas. Thank you for the symbolism of light. And Lord, may we this Christmas come to know Jesus as the light of the world. May we take this hope out with us into a world that is crying out for light and for hope in the midst of the darkness. Because we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.